Hi, this is Allison King from modernphoenix.net in Phoenix, Arizona. You're listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. Few architects have been as exciting or controversial as Paul Rudolph, whose early successes designing modernist vacation homes in Sarasota, Florida, led to a later career as chair of the architecture department at Yale, then nearly 30 years designing buildings with intense use of concrete and steel. While the public was largely inspired by his work, Rudolph fell out of favor in the U.S., and he shifted to Singapore and Hong Kong, where he was much heralded and sought after. Like most modernist architecture, over the years, Rudolph's houses and buildings around the world became highly prized and, at the same time, endangered. Joining us today is preservationist, archivist, and president of the Paul Rudolph Institute for Modern Architecture, Kelvin Dickinson. Later on, we'll enjoy some music from the charming jazz vocalist Tierney Sutton. And now here's your host, preservationist, archivist, and fan of Paul Rudolph, George Smart.
Hey, thanks, Tom. Modernist architecture is rarely well-received at the time of construction. If you build a stately Greek or Roman building of granite and marble with columns out front, no one will object. But if you build something innovative, there are going to be haters. It takes a while, sometimes years, but the public comes around to loving these buildings as part of their cherished city culture. In the late 1940s, in our town of Raleigh, North Carolina, Matthew Nowitzki created a hyperbolic paraboloid agriculture center, a.k.a. the State Fair Building, the likes of which the citizens of little old Mayberry had never seen. Dorton Arena was the first structure in the world to use a cable-supported roof based on two concrete arches that cross each other 26 feet above the ground and about 20 feet underground. Cables are strung underground between the two arches, tensioning them to support the whole structure. If you're having a hard time imagining this, just Google Dorton Arena. Dorton was the precursor to the Astrodome, the Superdome, and other sports arenas around the world. And when it opened, people admired the innovation, but generally did not like it at first. They called it a spaceship landing in a field. Our state legislature, not known for great decisions, went on an inspections visit and declared, with zero evidence or engineering data, that the cable system would not support the building. And they forced installation of giant concrete columns inside, which did absolutely nothing but increase the cost, ultimately slashing air conditioning from the budget. Now, 70 years later, the building is much loved and has a long history of iconic music concerts like Kiss and events like ice hockey, Ringling Brothers, Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling, classic car shows, and even roller derby. But there's still no air conditioning. If you're in Raleigh, it's a great stop on your architectural tour. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Diane Bald and the Budman family, restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Los Angeles, Malibu, and Palm Springs, and by modernist realtor Angela Roll.
In a classic tale that we are largely making up, modernist realtor Angela Roll worked her way through college, dancing like no one's watching to Mambo No. 5 and brilliantly house-flipping Neutra houses, sometimes simultaneously. At 22, following a celebrity-filled party at a famous hillside modernist house in L.A., involving late-night swimming, fig-infused goat cheese, absolute lime, and a new use for WD-40, Angela was recruited to architecture school. There, she spent years in sleep-deprived design studios. Now, she's a modernist real estate agent with specialized design training, advising buyers and sellers on everything, from appropriate renovation to staging a martini party for 200 people from 2,800 miles away. That last sentence is 100% true. Reach her at angelaroll.com. That's R-O-E-H-L, or 919-995-0550. Returning podcast guest Kelvin Dickinson has been a fan of Paul Rudolph ever since he was introduced to Rudolph's work by architect Peter Eisenman. After graduating in architecture from the University of Cincinnati,
go Bearcats,
he moved to New York and joined the Paul Rudolph Foundation in 2006, becoming co-director. From 2010, he worked in Doha, Qatar, returning in 2016 to the Paul Rudolph Heritage Foundation. It's now known as the Paul Rudolph Institute for Modern Architecture, where Kelvin is a tireless advocate for documenting and preserving Rudolph's work. Here's George's conversation with Kelvin Dickinson.
Kelvin, a lot of people have probably seen Paul Rudolph buildings or seen photos of them on the internet, but they don't know who Paul Rudolph was. Who was he?
So Paul Rudolph was at one point, and people may not know this, probably the most famous architect, modern architect in the United States, if not the world. And if you had grown up knowing anything about architecture in the 50s and 60s, he would have been probably the only architect you could have named at one point outside of Frank Lloyd Wright in the United States. He grew up, was born in 1918 in Elkton, Kentucky, and early on wanted to be an architect and studied under Walter Gropius at Harvard GSD, and then eventually at the early age of 40 became the chairman of the architecture department at Yale, where he famously designed probably his most famous building, the Art and Architecture Building, which, love it or hate it, kind of sealed his career. And early on, he was probably the most famous architect that anyone had ever heard of. Traveled the world, and people overseas knew him very well from a lot of the lectures he had given. And later in his career, when he became out of favor in the United States after a fire, unfortunately, at Yale in the late 60s, when he couldn't find work in the United States, over in Asia, they actually stayed very committed to modern architecture after postmodernism became the vogue in the United States. And he wound up resurrecting his career. So a lot of his later work is in Asia, where they still appreciate his work. To the point where when I had first heard of him in architecture school, we didn't even know who he was. We didn't even learn about him. I had to search for any mention of him in my library in the late 90s. So it was interesting. And so kind of what I realized was that here's somebody that I appreciate his work so much, and nobody knew who he was anymore.
Now, what was so controversial, that the love it or hate it part, about the Art and Architecture Building at Yale?
So Rudolph wanted to take, he was almost like Frank Lloyd Wright in a sense. He wanted to create an architectural aesthetic that was modern, that was different, that was not the same as what he was taught in school, which was this idea of universal space and strict functionalism that Mies and Walter Gropius were teaching. And he wanted to make it more heavy. He was inspired by travels he had done early on in his schooling over in Europe. And so he developed this building out of concrete, having been inspired after a meeting with Le Corbusier, and designed a building that was kind of a model of what modern architecture could look like, or a dream of what classical and traditional architecture had taught, which was ideas of monumentality, scale, material, urbanism. And so he creates this building that is celebrated worldwide. And then he leaves Yale, and Yale is taken over by people that aren't appreciative of it as much. There's a little bit of a controversy about the fire, whether it was actually done by students who protested the actual building, or if it was, unfortunately, a fire based upon some politics at the time. There was a lot of student protests in the late 60s at Yale.
So was the Vietnam War kind of stuff? Or
Black Panther, racism, issues regarding access of minority student applications in the program at the time. There was a lot of things going on. It was more than just the Vietnam War. But needless to say, there's been a lot of rumors, and it was unfortunately, the end result was that people assumed that they didn't like the building. And that's why it was set fire to. Unfortunately, as much as the fire damaged Rudolph's reputation, it was the person that took over the program after he left and made major changes to the interior such that he rejected Rudolph's some design aesthetic at the time.
Who was that guy?
Oh, goodness. I just had a name on the top of my head, right?
Was he the dean?
He was the chairman of the school at the time, took over for Rudolph.
Okay.
And he redesigned the building in such a way that he put a lot of walls in where there were open plans. Rudolph had this idea of a continual progress plan where you would kind of work your way up through the building and all the students could look on each other's work And in the center of the building was where the seniors had their design thesis and studio desks. And as you went up through the program, you could look down and see where you would ultimately wind up, where everyone could supposedly learn from each other's experience as you progress through the program. And unfortunately, the partitions and the walls that were put up as a result of the fire kind of tore that apart, such that Rudolph would never talk about the building again for the rest of his career. He would show up for a few crits, and he did do some work with students to put together some exhibitions, but he would never talk about the building and what happened to it.
At one point, the building was added onto by Gwathmey Siegel.
Yes.
And that seemed to go pretty well.
It did. They had a very deep appreciation for Rudolph's original intention. And it's actually, there was a couple of cases where there was an addition planned for that building. The original addition was planned by Meyer's office. Meyer's office has it on their website, actually. It was a rather interesting design because they intended to make it a very mechanical and almost glass box addition to the rather closed and windowless concrete heavy building that Rudolph had originally designed. And I think Gwathmey's office did a really good job of kind of picking up on that. It's a little bit of a contrast in design aesthetic. Some people love it. Some people hate it. I kind of fall in between. I think I do appreciate the fact that it is so different from Rudolph's original. And it did take care of a lot of original problems with the program, such as not having enough access, not having enough bathrooms. So there's a lot of program that was put into it that Rudolph didn't have in his original building. So in that case, it was very successful.
Now, would this be called a brutalist building?
The original, yes. The addition, I don't consider it brutalist. I would consider it a modern building in the sense that it's a building with an exterior skin that's composed of metal and glass and a lot of modern materials that would look like a building anywhere you would see in a modern city. I do think Rudolph's original building is kind of the epitome of what people consider when they think of brutalism. Rudolph famously wanted there to be less windows. He said more caves and less fishbowls was what he was always known for saying, in the sense that modernism in his day was too focused on exposed steel structure, the Mies idea of a glass box in the 50s, for instance, all glass with exposed steel structure and rectangular in form. And Rudolph's original building is brutalist in the sense that it does take that and flip it so that the building is more solid than glass. But it's also got some design aesthetics. I think it's got some ideas of scale. It's got some ideas of how you enter the building, which is kind of off to the side, which is very Wrightian in that sense. A lot of Wright buildings are not symmetrical, and you kind of have to go off to the side to discover how to enter it. And I think Rudolph really picked up on that.
Now, what did people love about Paul Rudolph's building? I mean, what was it that attracted so many fans to brutalism?
I think Rudolph, I've thought about this a lot because I have a lot of students that come visit us in our building here in New York. And I think over time, you know, a lot of Rudolph's students, his students, rejected Rudolph's work and were turned on by postmodernism. I'm thinking of Stanley Tigerman. I'm thinking of even Bob Stern and how he went into more of a classical aesthetic after he left Yale. But students today, I think, are all about branding. They're all about their personal expression. They understand consistency, of which Rudolph is very consistent. He had what he called itches, and those were things that were peculiar to him that he was interested in exploring. And if you look at his work, you can see those itches being displayed. Some are more important than others, depending on what project you're looking at. But I think that students today appreciate this idea of you don't change your design aesthetic at the drop of a hat. You don't sell out to a big corporate client and give them a glass box. You actually put some thought into it. You put some effort into the details that make the building unique as opposed to trying to just look like something that everyone else is doing in the magazines. And so I think that people appreciate that, that Rudolph was an original.
I've just been handed a slip of paper that said it was Charles Moore.
Yes,
who Charles was the Moore. Guy that did the renovations.
I was thinking Gwathmey, but Charles Moore, yes. Charles Moore, who actually recently is getting kind of a resurgence in reputation as people are rediscovering postmodernism.
Right, right. He was the one that did the renovations and put in the partitions and really chopped up the space, which seems to be
Kelvin, one of those cardinal sins, and we've certainly seen that in this area, when you take a modernist building and you start shoving lots of walls into it,
right,
you create more problems, like heating and air conditioning the thing becomes really painful.
And it's kind of like you went from the Victorian era where there was a dining room and a sitting room and a living room and everything had a room attached to it, and you opened up the floor plan in the 50s. And now people are doing the exact opposite. They're taking these open plans and they wanted to put the walls back in. And I don't know if it was for life safety, if it was, you know, there's always a joke that you can't be an art collector and have an open floor plan because you don't have any walls to put your art on.
Right.
And so I don't know if the pendulum was swinging back at the time he did that work, but I've seen photographs and I agree with Rudolph. I don't even recognize the space.
Another of Rudolph's buildings that is in the news now is the Government Center in Boston. What's that building about, and why are so many people up in arms about it?
So the Boston Government Service Center happens to be one of my personal favorites. I think it's a complete expression of what Rudolph intended to do with all of his work, which it dealt with issues of scale, monumentality, at the same time, material, it's all out of concrete. It's unfortunate in the sense that it's in Boston, where a lot of people support this idea of old Boston, classical, traditional looking buildings. And Rudolph steps in the 60s and designs a government service building as kind of a foil to the Boston City Hall project, which was done at the same time. And Rudolph's building was kind of taking the City Hall project and turning it inside out. So whereas the City Hall project is kind of an object in the middle of a large plaza for City Hall, and that famously is getting a lot of celebration from their new mayor, who loves the building. And then the Government Center takes that and internalizes it so that the outside of the building is kind of monumental. And then inside is this wonderful plaza, which unfortunately is hard to get to. And I think because it's owned by the state as opposed to the state has not taken very good care of it. It also happened to lump in a lot of things that people weren't happy about, such as it holds a mental health facility with residents that live there on site. And
really, I did not know that.
Yes, at the end of it. It's actually three buildings originally that Rudolph came in, and the government was not happy with how the three buildings were individually not working together. And so Rudolph was brought in to kind of tie it all together, which has actually made it hard to save the building because we have people in Boston and elsewhere who say, oh, Rudolph wasn't involved in the project. He was simply the guy that came in and organized all the actual architects to work together. But in fact, Rudolph was given the exterior of the building to design it after the three architects presented their plans and the government wasn't happy with how they weren't coordinated. So Rudolph kind of came up with a scheme of how to tie it all together, famously went off, built a model, showed up at a meeting and said, okay, everyone, here's what you're going to do. Presents a model, and it's this amazing design, what he called a stake and a tail. It was going to be a tower, which was the stake, and then a tail that kind of wrapped around at the street level and tied the whole building together. I think it's an example of brutalism, but at the same time, brutalism that references the environment it's in. And, you know, contrary to what some people have said, which was, and they're correct in some ways, that it tore down a neighborhood of middle-class workers and displaced a lot of people. But it also reflects Boston in the sense that it's almost looks like it was carved out by water. Unlike City Hall, which is kind of almost mechanical looking, Rudolph takes his concrete and curves it and adds all kinds of wonderful textures. So it's almost like a barnacle and it grows out of the ground. And these steps that sweep down, kind of Baroque looking steps, reflect water almost as if it's running down a hill. And I think it's very appropriate for the city. I do think, though, that it's had some bad rap from people that think it's too large. It's something that they want to redevelop. The current governor, Governor Baker, has asked DCAM, which is the organization that maintains all of the public buildings in Massachusetts, to sell it to a developer who will then either dismantle it or tear it down or we hope renovate it and build higher on the site so that they can get more gross square footage. And then they want to ostensibly take all of the other government offices located throughout Boston and consolidate them back on site, as well as lease out some of the space so that they can make money.
Well, let's unpack this a little bit. I mean, any state building complex that's built is going to displace middle-class families and lower-class families, no matter what style it is, right?
Correct. I mean, this is why I think it's a valid argument, but at the same time, I think it's an argument that could be made all over the place. So in that sense, it's not.
Yeah.
Progress is progress. I agree. And if you look at the reports that were generated, and I've read some of them, there were tenements, some without, obviously no sprinklers, some without indoor plumbing that were replaced by this building. That is why the building is located where it was and not located in some other areas where they actually had more development.
Let me play devil's advocate here a little bit. All the critics of the building, is there anything in their feedback that would be helpful towards a renovation which would keep the basic tone and look and feel of the building, but make it more usable and practical?
Yes, I think there have been a lot of arguments. I think that the building needs maintenance. I think that the building is often said it's dark, that there's not enough lighting, that it's unsafe. And I think that's a factor of the fact that the city needs to put more street light and light the building up. I mean, City Hall has been lit up fantastically so that it looks beautiful now. They're redoing the plazas. And the city has done a lot of work at City Hall, but the government, the governor at Boston Government Service Center has used these public plazas and turned them into surface parking lots, paved over Rudolph's original staircases and things that kind of flowed down into the space and turned them into surface parking lots.
Wait a second. In the middle of the building where that courtyard is parking?
Well, underneath there's parking. I'm talking the corners on the outside.
Okay.
There was intended to be seating and public sculpture. And a plaza that was going to be accessible to the public has been instead turned into surface parking.
Okay.
I think that those are arguments are totally valid. I think that you could potentially open up between the structural piers and put retail in the base of the building. I think that's totally doable as well, so that you get more activity at the street level. You know, the building was built at a time when people revered public and government's programs and services. This was the Great Society. This was when people were celebrating. There's a wonderful mural that's threatened as part of this redevelopment by Constantino Nebola. We've spoken to his family and his foundation about this and met them on site. And the murals are amazing. They celebrate government and what government can do to help, not government that's in the way, not government that's the kind of evil government you see on TV these days that make, you know, wonderful science fiction villains, but the government that actually helped people when they needed it. And these murals are scratched into the concrete walls of the original building in the lobby. Unfortunately, the governor and the state has put a policy in place that you can't go in, you cannot photograph them. And so, you know, this is one way of...
Wait a second, you can't photograph the buildings?
You can't go inside.
Inside, okay.
These murals are inside the lobby. And when we were there, we were told we couldn't photograph it. And we were there with the Nebola family, actually, when we were there. You know, it's a shame because if people got in and saw the interior of the buildings, I think these buildings would be more positively received. And the buildings in themselves, the outside is rather rigid, but the inside is an open plan. And so replanning the interiors, if that's what the city wants to do, the governor wants to do, actually, is a possibility. And I think that there's a middle ground that could be reached. I don't think demolition is the answer. But unfortunately, when you talk to developers, and having been an architect for so long, I know developers pretty well, developers would rather have a blank slate. They hate going in and having to work around an existing building, especially one that has, you know, famous murals in it and is ostensibly a landmark in its eligibility.
Yeah, and all those conversations you've got to have with all the different people and groups and things right, like that discourages them from these kinds of projects.
Absolutely.
What are some examples of Paul Rudolph projects that have been preserved and are doing really well?
So there's a couple of them. They're not always 100% preserved, unfortunately. A lot of them are residential. In some cases, you have the exterior of 23 Beekman Place is a landmark in New York City. It was originally potentially threatened because a neighbor had built a spite wall against it. And as part of the landmarking process, the spite wall was removed.
What is a spite wall? Is it what it sounds like?
It is. It's a wall. It was originally, a lot of them were built in Italy when neighbors would have a fight. Your neighbor might build a 20-foot tall wall to cover up all your windows. And so if you're next to another neighbor and you have a fight, the neighbor builds a wall up against the glass, and then all of a sudden you have no views out your apartment any longer.
Wow.
They took one down as part of the landmarking of 23 Beekman. Unfortunately, that apartment was sold and gutted shortly after Rudolph passed away back in 2002. So, you know, again, it's one of those things where it's preserved on the exterior, but not preserved on the interior. There's a house, the Yanofsky residence, which I visited recently up in Massachusetts, which is perfectly preserved. And it's got all of the original colors and the wallpaper, and it's just a fantastic house. And that has owners which are very careful to take care of it. They're, I believe, the second or third owners after the Yanofsky family sold it. And that's in perfect condition. And then you've got examples, and there's a lot of more of them, unfortunately, than there are of preservation, where things such as the Orange County Government Center was partially demolished and a horrible addition was put onto it. And the exterior was rebuilt, so it kind of resembles what was there. They added some parapets and they made some changes to the interior. I think some lighting that was not appropriate. And there's also examples of, I was just up at UMass Dartmouth at a brutalism conference back in October. They're making some changes to the library, and the library has made the interiors look refreshed and the colors are back, and it's exciting to see it, you know, appreciated again.
And what are some of the places that people should visit if they want to see examples of Paul Rudolph's work? I know that you all have an open house there at the Modulator building every month. That's one place.
Yes. Our space is one of the few that you can get to see an interior. It's the only one in New York City, actually, that's open to the public regularly. There's a lot of others that you can see from the exterior in New York, such as Tracy Towers or 23 Beekman Place, or even the Hirsch residence, which Halston famously owned over at 101 East 63rd Street. If you want to go see Rudolph outside of New York, there is the Tuskegee Chapel at Tuskegee University.
Oh, that's beautiful. Yes.
And there's a number of projects up in Boston. Obviously, you can see the exterior of Boston Government Services Center. There's a church, a Unitarian church that's there, which is brilliant and in perfect condition. It's very well taken care of. There are houses throughout the United States. I mean, Rudolph did so much. There's a little over 325 projects that we're aware of, and we keep finding out more.
And one of his early houses in Florida, the Walker Guest House, is so iconic, they made a duplicate of it.
Yes.
And it traveled from Florida to Palm Springs and was on view for a couple of years. And I think it got sold, right? Where is that now? Do you know?
It did. I don't know, actually. I'm not aware of who purchased it. So the original Walker House Guest House was sold at Sotheby's and later relocated. I believe it's somewhere out in California, waiting to be installed at a site maybe not too far from Palm Springs. And that is being preserved, although not at the same location. The Sarasota Architectural Foundation, now known as Architecture Sarasota, commissioned a copy, an exact replica, to be made by a pair of architects who were big Rudolph fans. Joe King was one of them. And they made a copy of it. The only thing they did was they put a handicap lift in place of the bathroom so that people could access it. It could be publicly accessible. And that was at Ringling for a number of months and then eventually made out to Palm Springs. That was sold. And I was hoping it would be sold to a university who could then put it on permanent display.
Display somewhere, yeah. Well, hopefully it'll surface somewhere.
Yes, yes. We're always looking out for it.
Now, one of my favorite toys growing up, great mid-century toy, was the Rock'em Sock'em Robots. Did you ever play with those, Kelvin?
I had one, yes.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. I think a big popular toy. And right now, you are involved in a Rock'em Sock'em Robot fight with another organization. What's that all about? Give
me
the scoop.
We will see whose head pops off first. So it's a sad story. It's actually kind of a lesson to be careful of if you are involved in a foundation of architects' legacy or anyone's legacy for that matter. It applies to artists as well as anyone else. When Rudolph passed away, he had a collection, an architectural collection of drawings. We estimate somewhere around 600,000 drawings, models and photographs and papers. And they were originally going to be donated to the Library of Congress and kept in place at 23 Beekman Place. And there was going to be a foundation created to then manage and allow the public to access it. The foundation was founded in 2002 by Mr. Ernst Wagner, who was the beneficiary of Rudolph's estate.
And Paul's partner in life.
Yes. And so this was originally the plan. Unfortunately, it didn't happen. 23 Beekman was not preserved. It was sold, and the money, the Library of Congress wanted the money to go down to preserve Paul Rudolph's works down in Washington, D.C., so that happened. But the foundation survived, and it was started in 2002, and then I eventually joined it in 2006, having met Ernst at an open house here at the Modulator building. And the foundation was the only foundation until I eventually left in 2010, and by that point, a number of people had joined the foundation, younger people, people that didn't know who Paul Rudolph was, the generation removed. And so when I left to go work overseas briefly, I got a phone call from Mr. Wagner, who told me that they had kicked him out. And he consequently had created a second foundation. So there was originally a Paul Rudolph Foundation. Now there is two foundations. There's a Paul Rudolph Foundation and a Paul Rudolph Heritage Foundation. And when I returned from the Middle East, where I was working back in 2015, I immediately joined the Paul Rudolph Heritage Foundation and ultimately in 2018 became full-time staff member, executive director, and president of the Paul Rudolph Heritage Foundation. Unfortunately, the two foundations don't work together. And we asked in a state court case for what's known as a replevin action to have some drawings returned that belonged to Mr. Wagner. And consequently, as a result, the other foundation, the Paul Rudolph Foundation, served the Heritage Foundation and Mr. Wagner with a federal case for trademark violation. And we are currently working through both of those cases right now.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that, you know, because there's so much work to be done about keeping these buildings, I mean, standing, first of all, and then secondly, maintained and taken care of in accordance with how they were designed.
And that's the part that's the most upsetting about all of this. It takes a lot of energy to go through this, to defend yourself. Ernst is in his late 70s, and it's very draining to go through and talk to countless hours with lawyers when you would rather be out there trying to preserve Paul Rudolph's built works, because ultimately, it's nothing if all it is in a book. I mean, that's my opinion, is that you can go through a book, pull it off the shelf, and look at photographs, but it doesn't matter if the buildings don't exist and you can't walk into them and experience them firsthand. I think that's the most important thing. And that suffers as the result of all of this.
So does mediation for this kind of dispute work like divorce mediation? I mean, like, do people get in a room and there's a very nice lady who speaks quietly to both parties and you try to figure out who's going to get the lawnmower, that kind of thing?
Yes, that's my understanding of what to expect.
Okay.
I'm hoping that the mediation is successful. I mean, ultimately, there's nothing that we can't resolve. I do think, though, that when you're talking about an architect's legacy, or anyone's legacy for that matter, of this size and this importance, there are people that come along and they think that, you know, they own it. In this case, I think that the estate, Mr. Rudolph, left his legacy in the care of Mr. Wagner. He wanted to have his works preserved, and he wanted his legacy to be donated to an institution and have a foundation that was created to preserve and educate about his future students about his work. And Mr. Wagner, while Paul was in the hospital, made a promise that he would do that. Ultimately, in the will, Mr. Wagner's name is the only name that appears, and Ernst takes that very seriously. And he founded the first foundation as a group dedicated to preserve Mr. Rudolph's works. They had a disagreement over their intent, you know, over how they wanted to preserve it. And Ernst was ultimately removed and created the Heritage Foundation. I think that ultimately I defer to Mr. Wagner's wishes because Mr. Wagner was there. Ernst talked to Paul about what their plans were. And actually the board members that were part of the original Paul Rudolph Foundation that actually knew Mr. Rudolph in person left and joined the Heritage Foundation in protest when Ernst was removed from the original Paul Rudolph Foundation that he created.
Okay. Well, I really wish you the best of luck at that.
Thank you. I'm sure it will work out in the end.
When people come and visit Modulator, what's it like? What's some of the programming that you do there? Because I think it's one of the most, underappreciated tourist spots for architecture in New York.
Thank you. Yeah, it's kind of undiscovered. I'm always surprised to meet people that say, oh, I've walked by here all the time and I've always wanted to go inside and I didn't know I could. And they also are surprised to realize it's not made out of concrete. I get that asked all the time. And so it's a building that was designed by Rudolph to solve a number of problems. He was creating a lighting company in 1976. He created light fixtures originally for his own use, and then they were in his projects. And then later he discovered that they were so successful, he could design and build light fixtures for other people's projects. And as the company grew, it needed a new headquarters. And Rudolph designed a building in 1989 to house the Modulighter Lighting Company. And the ground floor and the sub-basements are where they make the light fixtures. So we can talk about lighting. There's a showroom. People can see Rudolph's ideas of lighting and modularity and how it's expressed in the creation of the light fixtures and the fact that it's all made on site. But also we have a building designed by Rudolph with an apartment that was originally designed as a way to raise money for Mr. Rudolph when his office was slow. And we open that to the public so we can show off what it's like to be inside a Rudolph space. And then we also have an event space, which was later added using drawings for the building facade that we had in our archives, where we open the event space to other people to talk about architecture and things that Rudolph used to do at 23 Beekman Place when he was still alive, where he would invite students to come over and they would sit around and talk about architecture. So in this case, we use our event space as a way to host lecture series, and we rent it out for people as well as a way to raise money for the foundation so that people can use it for their own functions as well. And ultimately, the building, I want it to become a teaching tool, both as a destination for people to visit and see Rudolph's work, but also to be educated about Rudolph's understanding of modern architecture and its importance while you're sitting in a Rudolph designed space. The big picture of the future of our space is ultimately when the building is left to the Heritage Foundation, which has already been arranged, we are going to open it as a study center for modern architecture in general, so that we will host other nonprofit historic preservation organizations dedicated to preserve modern architecture, so that it becomes more of a group effort and not solely about Mr. Rudolph, because I think his ideas of modern architecture are bigger than just himself.
That was my conversation with Kelvin Dickinson, recorded earlier this year. But there's been some updates on the Rock'em Sock'em Rudolph battle of the foundations and a name change. So back with us now in April. Hello again, Kelvin.
Hi, how are you doing, George?
What's the latest on the litigation and the name change?
So we are actually in the middle of mediation. We have decided to sit down, both of the sides, and discuss our differences in the hopes that we can come to some kind of understanding of how we can work together in the future.
That sounds very civilized, Kelvin. Do you think you could extend this to world leaders?
Well, I'd like to think that maybe we can set an example, but I don't know if they'll listen to us.
I see. How did you come about the name change?
So the name change is something we've been thinking about for quite some time. It kind of is not necessarily related to the court case, but mostly because having been involved in what was originally the Paul Rudolph Foundation, later the Heritage Foundation, and now the Institute, I've noticed personally, and the group has, that we want to take Paul Rudolph's teachings and not keep it as a memorial to his past and his buildings that he had already built, especially given that he's no longer alive and no longer creating, but take what his principles were in his work and take that towards the future. And I think it's an apropos time to do so. This just happened while we were in the process of working out our differences with the other foundation. But this was not something that was connected to it, that we had already been planning on doing this. We have changed our name to the Paul Rudolph Institute for Modern Architecture, and that was because we wanted to talk less about heritage and more about the future and how Rudolph's principles, marrying a traditional way of looking at architecture with modern materials and his what he called his DNA of architecture, could be applied to other architects and other work and take his way of looking at architecture and teach it for the future.
Paul Rudolph has always been an inspiration to architects and clients, but this is taking it to a whole other level.
We wanted to do something that we could actually have students look at and go, you know, it's not something you study in a book and you put it away and put it on a shelf, but it's actually something that you can, once you understand it, apply it to your own work, and hopefully architecture in the future will be the better for it.
What's the new website?
So the new website is www.paulrudolph.institute, which I know for some people are going to be very relieved that our long name has been shortened.
Dot Institute, that's a new one.
That's yes. A domain, really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool.
So we're now known as the Institute, yes.
You can now view all of Rudolph's houses at our archive, usmodernist.org/Rudolph. Thanks, Kelvin.
Great. Thanks, George.
That was George Smart and Kelvin Dickinson. 9-time Grammy-nominated jazz vocalist Tierney Sutton grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, which is also home to Liberace, Gene Wilder, and Alice Cooper. She graduated from Wesleyan University.
Go Cardinals!
And attended the Berklee College of Music in Boston.
Go Mingus the Jazz Cat!
Since 1993, she has fronted the Tierney Sutton Band, heralded for using her voice as an instrument and for her skill as a storyteller in song. Her recordings addressed themes such as materialism and the pursuit of happiness, as well as paying tribute to Bill Evans, Frank Sinatra, and Sting. She's taught at USC's Thornton School of Music and spent 6 years as the vocal department head at the Los Angeles College of Music. Welcome, Tierney.
Hi there. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's great to have you on. I wanted to ask, because I don't think everyone knows what this means, what is it to use your voice as an instrument?
Well, one of the things I like to say is that in jazz, the instrumentalist that move me the most are the instrumentalists that sound like they're singing through their instrument. And in the same way, the singers that move me the most are singers that really sound like the instruments. And so the tradition of jazz is following kind of an instrumental phrasing, an instrumental path to a large degree. And there's a lot of artists that exemplify this, like Al Jarreau, for example, or Bobby McFerrin, of course, Ella Fitzgerald, and scat singing. But it isn't just scat singing. It's also a way of phrasing. Billie Holiday's phrasing was very strongly influenced by instrumentalists. So this is not uncommon.
This first song debuted in 1937 in the Rodgers and Hart musical Babes in Arms. It was first performed on stage by Ray Heatherton, father of Joey Heatherton, and Mitzi Green. Dion and the Belmonts made it a hit again in 1955, and it's been covered by the Beach Boys, Nat King Cole and Natalie Cole, Michael Bublé, Lena Horne, Barbra Streisand, Idina Menzel, and Taye Diggs, one of my favorites, Julie London, and even George Michael. Here's Tierney from her album, Dancing in the Dark, with Where or When.
It seems we stood and talked like this before. We looked at each other in the same way then, but I can't remember where or when. The clothes you're wearing are the clothes you wore. The smile you're smiling, you were smiling then, but I can't remember where or when. Some things that happen for the first time, they seem to be happening again. And so it seems that we have met before and laughed before and loved before, but who knows where or when. Yeah, it seems we stood and talked like this before. Each other in the same way then, but I can't remember where or when. The clothes you're wearing are the clothes you wore. The smile you're smiling, you were smiling then, but I can't remember where or when. Some things that happened for the first time, they seem to be happening again. And so it seems that we have met before. We've laughed before, we've loved before. But who knows where or when? Where or when? Where or when?
That is beautiful.
Thank you so much.
Hey, I was wondering, Tierney, have you gotten a chance to go to Haifa yet in Israel?
Oh, I've been in Haifa, let's see, 3 or 4 times.
I got a chance to go to the Baha'i Gardens there.
Oh, which,
the tiered
so
gardens, which are just extraordinary.
Yeah, they really, truly are.
These are gardens that are in levels, I guess it goes down about, what, 300 or 400 feet down the side of a hill?
Yeah, there are 19 terraced gardens. The first 7 or 8 are above the shrine, and the second 10 or whatever are below the shrine. And they're really, really incredible. And I was there before those terraces existed. And so watching the terraced gardens come into creation was really something. And they even straightened the street in Haifa so that it would lead up to the terraced gardens in a beautiful way. The city decided to do that.
And this is one of the monuments for your faith, the Baha'i faith. I didn't realize that these gardens were that new. I thought they'd been there like 100 years.
No. And bringing them about, it's an interesting thing because only members of the Baha'i faith can give money towards the building of the gardens. We're funny about the money thing. We're the opposite, maybe, of every other religion. You can't give us money. We don't want your money. Please do not give us money. So it's literally against our religion to take money for the building of our holy places. Only enrolled Baha'is can give money to those gardens, and it's completely anonymous who gives and how much they give. And so it took the first planning of those gardens was in the 30s or 40s, and it took that long for them to acquire the land.
When were they finished up?
Gosh, I think they were finished in 2013, 2014, something like that. I'm not really sure. I'd have to look it up.
That was not a quick construction job.
No.
It took a long time because it's not so easy to buy land in Israel. They don't just let you buy land very easily. So it's quite a story, and it's a really interesting thing because the Baha'is have a really interesting and unique relationship with the Israeli government and really appreciate the Israeli government and do not proselytize or teach about the Baha'i faith in Israel at all, according to our holy writings. So it's very interesting. The whole thing is very interesting, but the gardens are exquisite. It's really something.
Now, speaking of monuments, what was it like to work with Clint Eastwood on film Sully about the famous airline pilot landing in the Hudson?
That was a really incredible experience. And the interesting thing about that experience is that it was only possible for us to do what we did because the band had been together over 20 years by that point, or about 20 years. And we'd been working collaboratively for all that time, the Tierney Sutton Band and me. When Clint approached us, first he just asked Christian Jacob and me to come to Warner Brothers and watch a rough cut of something where he said he was using a few examples of our music in the film. And we thought, oh, he's just asking to license this or maybe asking us to record a few things. But instead, the whole movie played and the only pieces of music were 2 little a cappella things of me and 1 little track of Christian playing. And after the film, all the editors and Clint and the producers turned around to us and said, well, and it was really interesting because quite literally within 4 days from this, we were in the studio recording Two Picture with Clint, with the band.
Have you ever had an experience like that before?
Yeah, all the time. No, I mean, well, I mean, in a way, that's kind of a yes and no. Of course, nothing quite like that. But it's very interesting because the band had scored an independent film a few years before that. And so we had done film cues, and all of us had worked on films before. And we got together and we spotted the film. That's what it's called when you figure out what are the themes you want to put in the film. And very quickly, we adapted a theme that Clint gave us, and Christian wrote a couple of themes. And we sat and consulted about little bits of music. By that time, we had done over 100 arrangements together of things. And so we could say, oh, remember this little thing that we did in this arrangement? What if we did a little something like that here and used this theme? And so it was a really incredible experience and one that not very many people get. So I'm very grateful for that.
So you were all ready to go for this. You were ready to push the button and go.
They were lucky to have you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think the producers of the film were a little shocked because they thought, oh, Clint is, you know, he's lost it now. He picked this little lounge band to do the music for his film, and they had no idea that Christian is a sublime orchestral arranger. And so he took our band tracks and then wrote the most glorious strings. And the best part of the whole experience, honestly, is that because of Clint, we ended up doing an album based on the music that we prepared. And it wasn't just what made it into the movie. It was lots of cues that didn't make it into the finished film, but are great music. And it's called Sully, music inspired by the film Sully. And it was put out by Varese Saraband. And it has Christian's full 9-minute orchestral themes. And it's just beautiful.
That's neat.
That's cool. Yeah. That's cool.
It was very cool.
From Tierney's album Dancing in the Dark, Frank Sinatra released this song in 1953, written by Jimmy Van Heusen and Carl Sigman, later recorded by Della Reese, Shirley Horn, Sammy Davis Jr., and late in his career, Bob Dylan. Here's Tierney with I Could Have Told You.
I could have told you he'd hurt you, he'd love you a while and then desert you. If only you'd asked, I could have told you so. I could have saved you some crying. Yeah, I could have told you he's lying, but you were in love and didn't want to know. I could have told you so. toss and turn and try to sleep. I hear him now. Making promises he'll never keep. And soon it's over and done with. He'll find someone new to have fun with. Through all of my tears, I could have told you so. Through all of my tears, I could have told you so.
And the camera pans out to a man crying, eating a half a gallon of Rocky Road ice cream.
Indeed, indeed. Well, exactly. Or if you're to a woman, yeah.
Yeah.
I love that song because it's such a different perspective than we usually get. You get a woman talking, in my case, a woman talking to another woman who's her friend who fell in love with the same guy, maybe stole the guy from me.
Yeah.
And I could have told you he'd hurt you because he's not a good guy, but you were in love. I mean, how true that we know that story. We all know that story.
Mm. We had another musical guest on, Rose Mallette from Palm Springs, who has a song called The Snake with similar themes there.
Yeah.
Tierney, you're doing live performances again. Is anything different now than before COVID?
Wow. Well, what's different is I think we have a different kind of appreciation for it. And I think the audiences have a different kind of appreciation. I just got back last night from a weekend in Virginia, and the weekend before I was in Philly and Sarasota, Florida. And I feel like there's kind of a depth of energy going between me and the audience and coming back to me than I ever remember having. It's really, I think things have kind of deepened, you know, people feel the need to really be connecting in a live performance. And I definitely feel it after not doing it for 2 years.
Well, we're really glad to have you back. And thank you so much for sharing this music with us today.
Well, thank you. And I hope people will look for me on the road. My website is tierneysutton.com. And I love to have people on my email list so I can be in touch with them. It's really nice because, you know, we bop around and we want to be connected with people that love the music. I have a new record coming out. It's called Paris Sessions 2. It's got some beautiful standards on it. It's with my husband, Serge Merlot, on guitar, and Hubert Laws on flute, and wonderful Kevin Axt on bass. It's got beautiful stuff, and we'll be touring that record in May and June and beyond. So,
thanks, Tierney.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for listening. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Diane Bald and the Budman Family, restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Los Angeles, Malibu, and Palm Springs. And by Modernist Realtor Angela Roll. Okay, Tom, let's go.
Visit usmodernist.org's massive archives to listen to past shows, discover documentation of 15,000 significant modernist houses, and access 4 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song is performed by George Smart and Robinson Earl. Rogue archivist Carrie Cesarino researches guests while juggling two kids and a cat that thinks it can type. Mostly it just fills her keyboard up with cat hair. U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive Incorporated, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. I'm Tom Guild. George and I'll be back soon with another strong, controversial, concrete and steel edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.